Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to all of you from the already quite warm Greece. I would like to thank you all for attending my seminar. Obviously, I would love to be there with you right now, but let's hope that we will have the chance to do so in the near future. I would also like to thank Mr. Alex Khalil and the Department of Music for their honorable invitation. I confess that I am jealous of you having such an inspiring academic as your professor. Today we are going to discuss a rather uncommon aesthetical clock of our beloved piano. The present study constitutes part of a broader project which, in the form of postdoctoral research, is funded by the State Scholarships Foundation of Greece and is titled Eastwards Heterotopias of the Piano. The musical implementations that we study constitute heterotopias, following the concept of the renowned lecture of Foucault. It is hard to examine this music with national concepts or to lock them within the political geographical borders that they were recorded, because they are more like spiritual and cultural places. The basic characteristic of such places is syncretism, dynamics, and fluidity. The movement and the passing towards the other, the different. These places are non-ordinary, however real. The term eastwards is purposefully used instead of the term east, because it is deemed less imaginary, at least for the period under question, which is the period of the great phenomenon of recording technology during the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Quite often, we think of the East as a very specific geographical and cultural territory, and that a rivalry exists towards an also imaginary West. The basic aim of this research project is the highlighting of a special and unexplored aspect of the piano, its role outside of its usual context, which is what we usually call classical music. The project focuses on discography found in various musical realities within a broad geographical span: Eastern Europe, the Balkans, the Eastern Mediterranean, the Middle East, and North Africa. The modeness found in these repertoires constitutes a common feature, which through historical discography often outlines in between places of the familiar stereotypical dipole forms, for example, the dipoles popular scholarly, West and East, foreign and ours. I'm aware that there is a term here that makes you wonder somehow: modeness. Therefore, I believe I ought to explain the way I'm using it. Let's have an interlude on modeness then. The term is used purposefully in order to include definitions usually consigned to the words popular, East, and modality. The problems regarding the first two are patently clear. The in-between places between the poles of the high status and the popular, and that of the East and the West, are innumerable and hardly distinguishable. The third word, modality, presents two problematic points. On the one hand, it has been wrongfully connected to Eastern musics, even though it does not constitute their exclusivity. On the other hand, it describes a simple systematic analysis of melodic movement and, rarely, its harmonization. The alternative term, modeness, renders, in its totality, the behavior of a musical entity with its specific characteristics, that is, rhythm, melody, harmony, and so on, as the epicenter. Not, however, as a theoretical substance with self-contained rules, but as an implemented case. In other words, how it functions in the artistic act is examined, its creation context and utilization, the implementation of its protagonists, that is, musicians, intermediaries, and audience, performance practice and technique, technological issues, and so forth. This approach incorporates those elements described by the terms East and modality, simultaneously expanding their scope. At the same time, though, it highlights a fundamental characteristic of popular music expression, which is none other than the orality and ensuing fluidity during realization. Modeness is born out of the musical concept of the performance, placing the person artist and their musical experiences at the epicenter, relegating the mechanized theoretical stereotypes to the background. In other words, modeness is not opposed to the West and the scholarly, but it also does not replace the Eastern and the popular. Parallelly, it seems to exist as a tool in performance practices of not only popular musicians, but also scholarly ones. This emerged modeness transforms these two large groups from typical categorizations which depend on their product to more humanistic entities which depend on the creator of the product, permitting and facilitating the examination of the material which was created by the musicians who serve both categorizations. Let's go back to our main subject now. The piano is present in the live performance, but also in the discography of the repertoire in question. In the latter, we find it even in the time period of the mobile recording workshops, that is, right from the start of commercial discography, which is around 1900s. In discography, the piano appears in its familiar classic identity, but it also appears in an alternative aesthetical attire. It performs a different repertoire in a different manner, constructing an autonomous entity. These alternative aesthetics, active even in the present, remained excluded from research. The examination and analysis of historical discography allows provision for the establishment of an electronic database, which includes the piano pieces that have been found. The database already contains 500 historical recordings. I should underline that the search and the finding of the recordings is based more on qualitative characteristics than on quantitative. The basic aim is the representation of as more musical idioms as possible. The main goal here is not to find all the recordings, something which seems impossible, but the mapping of the recording material, analyzing and comparing the cases. Until today, the relevant bibliography is scarce. There is a very recent doctoral dissertation that comes from a French university and deals with the African North and the French colonies. Apart from this, a few biographies of some pianists exist, which also concern the French colonies. We should talk about historical discography here, in order to create an image of this period, a framework. In the early 20th century, the recordings are conducted by mobile workshops, which travel to countless regions to record local musicians. These workshops are deployed by large companies, such as the English Gramophone, the German Odeon, and the French Pathe. Discographical research reveals that musical networks are created rapidly, in which music and musicians dwell. For example, we see wandering musical melodies in various places in the Mediterranean, the Balkans, Eastern Europe, and America, where local musicians become familiar with them and reconstruct them, but also borrowings in performance practices. The capacity of the repertoire is endless, which is deterritorialized and blended with other repertoires, forming now glocalized characteristics. The cosmopolitan traits of the large urban centers, in combination with the new technological means, promote polystylisms and polymorphisms of the musical realities. It is important to understand the context of discography by mobile workshops, as there are still no suitably designed sites, adequate audio media, specific corporate policies, not even specific local musical identities, as the musicians themselves are often on the go, employing a variety of repertoires and coming from diverse ethnocultural groups. In other words, we see the piano in this early discography only if it already exists in one of the sites chosen by the recording workshop, for example, a big hotel hall. The appearance of the piano in discography is more recurrent in the era of the local factories, obviously because in the factory it is a permanent fixture in the recording studio. The fact that in America we see it firmly established much earlier is no coincidence, as the factories of the large companies there constitute the sole condition. This type of pianistic repertoire in discography is detected with certainty in the following countries: Russia, Serbia, Slovakia, Romania, Greece, Turkey, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Israel, Lebanon, Egypt, Tunisia, Algeria, India, and Iran. Obviously, the performances and repertoires differ from place to place. Should we talk about two entities which ensue from the listening to the material of this extensive geographical span, we may say that it is the harmony which differs from place to place. In certain instances, its presence is intense, for example, in Russia, Romania, and Greece. While in others it is not, for example, in Algeria and Tunisia. On the other hand, there are geographical areas, such as Turkey, where implementation of both categories is observed. A common feature of this geographical area, despite the large diaspora, is the presence of a particular syncretism, which by rule hosts both stereotypical entities, the West and the East. Three large categories result from the examination of the material: recordings which present quite clearly an Eastern modeness, recordings whose modeness is probably more Easternesque, and recordings in which a balance of elements, Eastern or Easternesque with Western or Westernesque, is observed. What is especially important is the fact that these possibly summarized and virtual categories are not wholly connected to one geographical area. In many cases, a blend in the discographical repertoire within the same geographical region is observed. Another characteristic observed in some of these areas is the marginality of performance practices, which waver between what is often called, in the words of the musicians, as playing by ear, and that of a more standard, even though clearly fluid, manner of performance. When the piano infiltrates these traditions, not only does it oblige us to reevaluate the boundaries between Western and Eastern music, but also their supposed opposition within an especially charged polarizability. It also allows us to deconstruct all kinds of exoticisms, revealing evidence of a creative coexistence which transcends conventional borders and political stereotypes. One of the fundamental stereotypes which is put to the test by the heterotopias of the piano is the opposition between scholarly and popular musicians. Even in traditions where the piano is relatively inaccessible, the artists do not hesitate to borrow practices and dialects phenomenally unfamiliar in order to express themselves creatively. Indeed, in many cases, these same artists record repertoires which originate from both categories. As far as this exchange between the scholar and the popular is concerned, a rather illustrative example is the case of Yorgos Batsanos, by religion a Christian, a resident of Constantinople, today Istanbul, during the switch from the condition of the Ottoman Empire to the Turkish democracy, of Gypsy stock and Greek speaking. He was born in 1900s and died in 1977. Batsanos is known for the redefinition and popularity which the oud acquired, quite a popular instrument in the Ottoman repertoire, scholar and popular. Despite this, perhaps influenced by the Europeanization of the Ottoman Empire, he records with a piano as well. In his historical Taksim, recorded circa 1928, he uses the same technique as the one used in the gazelle, that is, a style of vocal improvisation based on sacred text sung by Kemal Bey some years later. In these recordings, the effort to implement the canon technique is evident. Technology and the sound architecture of the piano seem to help Batsanos not only to implement but also to evolve it on the spot. All this in an improvisation in which, theoretically, he must adhere to a specific composition form, which many times functions with the rationale of the theoretically orthodox. In his attempt to achieve this goal, the piano does not seem to hinder Batsanos, who complies with a traditional perspective regarding melodic development of the makam, that is, the Ottoman-style mode called hijaskyar. If nothing else, Batsanos reveals that he has fully comprehended the mechanics of the instrument, how it functions, something which helps him to transcend the mimicked canon. Batsanos dismisses the theoretical orthodox and grants us historical recordings with the piano, outlining the in-between of West and East, a pragmatic place of a period which is characterized by the dialogical reciprocity among the cultural diversities. This specific piano technique we just listened to is familiar, as we have detected it in other regions as well. For example, Mezaoud Habib, a Sephardic Jew in Tunisia, also records an improvisation utilizing similar practices on the instrument. Habib begins his recording career since the 20s. We found even piano rolls which were created by him in Paris. This specific recording by Habib takes place circa 1928. It must be pointed out that Tunisia is one of the countries in North Africa where we see a multitude of historical recordings with the piano in this type of role. Apart from the Arab world, in Africa North, huge numbers of Sephardic Jews live. At the same time, these regions are French colonies. Bachanos, however, is a protagonist in popular repertoires too. That is, he performs at night in music halls. This type of repertoire, again with the piano, is recorded with his brother Alekos, who plays the kemenche, that is, a lyre. Yorgos accompanies his brother in a singular manner. What is interesting is the structure, which passes through one section of the piece to go to the other. Evidently, they perform together and feel artistic familiarity with each other. On the other hand, Yorgos seems to know the instrument, and in combination with knowing the repertoire well, he lays the rhythmic harmonic foundation for Alekos, transcending the theoretical issues of the equal-tempered, untempered dipole. The way in which he creates sound on the piano is something worthy of analytical examination. He seems to possess a singular perception of the keyboard, the sound colors of the instrument, but also the implementation of modality on the piano. A catalyst of this is his ethnocultural roots, which urge him constantly onto new audio discoveries and experimentation. So far, 12 recordings where he appears to play the piano have been partially validated. Let's go now to one of my favorites, Colea Serban, a Romanian and Gypsy as well. He was born in 1924 and died in 1974. Here we are dealing with a formidable player who is aware of his skill, to which his classical studies were conducive, to a certain degree, obviously, but also the tools offered by the orality condition, as he clearly shows us that he is familiar with the popular environment. The specific contextual rendition of the famous tune titled Hora Mori constitutes an adaptation of the Rhapsody of George Enescu, who incorporated this melody into his piece, claiming that he had heard it like this from the lautari, that is, the Romanian gypsy popular musicians. the new element added, the improvisation in between, where Serban illustrates that perhaps in this way the piece is now complete. At the same time, the great ruler of Romanian music, the cymbalon, keeps the rhythm for the piano improvisation. An extremely interesting case is Iran. There, the musicians do not hesitate to tune their instrument differently, something still in practice today. In the next audio example, we will hear Ostad Adib Kansari singing and Ostad Moretenza Mahubi on the piano. Unfortunately, discographical validation is difficult. We know that Mahubi was born in 1900 and died in 1965. We also know that he played piano for Golha Radio, the national Iranian radio station. Different tuning was also detected in Lebanon, with which I am going to put a full stop. Abdallah Shahin, born in 1894, and with studies in music but also studies in the manufacture and maintenance of the piano, designed a not well-tempered piano, which was eventually manufactured in Vienna by the Hoffmann factory in cooperation with the runner industry of Stuttgart. Some recordings were conducted with this instrument circa 1960, which are still available today on CD. A sample of the recordings is the following.